press sound. Obviously, in half an hour, it's not enough to take the complete abdominal ultrasound, so I will highlight a few points that I think that are important on the ICU or the emergency department. If you have any questions, please interrupt me. It can be very interactive. Okay, I divided my talk a little bit in between. First, liver disease. What kinds of liver disease are important for you on the ICU or in the emergency department? Then a little bit more about gallbladder disease, renal disorders, abdominal aneurysm and abdominal aorta disorders, to end with abdominal traumata. First, liver disease. Liver disease obviously is very diverse. We will start with the cardiac liver. What can you appreciate with your abdominal ultrasound if you have cardiac failure? First of all, we have aspecific signs. The liver will be enlarged. We have pleural effusion. We can have ascites. And then the two most important things that we can see, you have a dilatation of the hepatic veins, and we have a dilatation of the inferior caval vein. Immediately, some images. This is the liver. These are the normal hepatic veins. And this happens when there is cardiac failure. You have a severe dilatation of the hepatic veins. And if you want to measure it, you can measure it 2 centimeters from the inferior caval vein. We go upwards. And if the diameter is larger than 1 centimeter, we can say on the abdominal ultrasound that probably there will be some heart failure. The same for the inferior caval vein. This is what we appreciate here underneath the liver. It's dilated, and we always ask the patients to inspirate and expirate. And when you see that the diameter is the same with expiration and inspiration, we have signs on the abdominal ultrasound for heart failure. Let's go to liver steatosis. Probably if you have on the ICU disturbed liver test, the gastroenterologist will come and says the patient has liver steatosis. How does he see that? This is what we see normal. This is the parenchyma of the liver, and here we have the parenchyma of the kidney, and normally it's completely the same. If you have a patient with liver steatosis, then we talk about a bright liver. The parenchyma of the liver is much more white than the parenchyma of the kidney. So this is liver steatosis. This is something that we see in 1 in 3 patients. So 30% of the general population has liver steatosis. Let's go to liver cirrhosis. What can we see if you have a patient with liver cirrhosis? First of all, and I will demonstrate you some pictures about that, you have rounded marginal edges. The liver surface will be irregular. You have nodular liver surface. There will be a dysmorphism of the liver. What does this mean? That some parts of the liver will enlarge and other will atrophy. Sometimes you can have an increased echogenesis, and the echo structure of the liver will be heterogeneous. And obviously, you also can have some signs of portal hypertension. First, this is a normal liver, sharp edge, and this happens with a patient with cirrhosis. The edges become rounded. This is what you see. This is a cirrhotic liver. You see the nodularity, and this is also what we see with the ultrasound. There is a lot of ascites in this patient, and you have the nodularity of the liver. Very easy to appreciate. Here the same, a nodular border of the liver, and the parenchyma is heterogeneous. It's not homogeneous, it's heterogeneous. It becomes more difficult if you don't have ascites, because ascites gives a contrast. And if the ascites disappears, then it's more difficult. But still, you can appreciate in this patient that there is some nodularity. And here as well, there is some nodularity. Normally, this should be a sharp edge. Here, the same nodularity of the border of the liver. This is cirrhosis. This nodularity, obviously, is not only on the outside of the liver, it also happens on the inside of the liver. And remember, these were the hepatic veins in a normal patient, and this happens with the hepatic veins in a cirrhotic patient. So the nodularity from the outside also is visible in the inside of the liver. Dysmorphism, this is very important. Some parts of the liver will enlarge and other parts will be atrophic. And the most important thing is that we have a hypertrophy of the caudate lobe. I will demonstrate you some pictures. This is a normal caudate lobe. It's rather small. And this happens in patients with cirrhosis. It gets larger, it gets more rounded borders. So if you see this with another nodularity of the liver, it's very specific for liver cirrhosis. Here once again, this is the lobus caudatus, the caudate lobe, which is really large. Obviously, if the liver cirrhosis is quite severe and if the patient has, for example, thrombopenia, then we can have signs of portal hypertension. Which are the signs of portal hypertension? Splenomegaly, ascites, and also collaterals. Portal hypertension means that the tension in the portal vein is too high and you will have a dilatation of the portal vein. This is what you see here, a clear dilatation of the portal vein. Normally, the flow goes to your liver. What happens in severe liver disease, then the flow goes away from your liver. So hepatofugal, that means that the flow goes away. If the cirrhosis is very severe, you can appreciate this. Sometimes you have a repermeabilization of the umbilical vein, and the umbilical vein, remember, leaves from the left portal vein. Normally, after birth, it disappears, but in portal hypertension patients, it can reappear, and this is what we see then. This is the ligamentum teres, and in the ligamentum teres, you can see here a repermeabilization of the umbilical vein as a sign of portal hypertension. Sometimes it gets even larger and larger, and this is the caput medusae that we know from our physical examination, and you can follow it going to the umbilicus. So this is portal hypertension, severe portal hypertension. Here, once again, outside the liver, running to the umbilicus. Sometimes we can appreciate collaterals, especially in patients with hepatic encephalopathy. This is the spleen. Spleen is enlarged, but here you see all kind of veins in the hilus of the spleen. This is clear portal hypertension, portal systemic collaterals. And then ascites, very important. If there is only a minority of ascites, you will appreciate it in the Morrison pouch. So that means between the right kidney and the liver. And then you see this. This is the crescent sign. This is only 250 milliliters of fluid. So when you have a little bit of ascites, you see it here and in the Douglas pouch. And if it gets more, then you see what we saw in the previous patients. The liver swimming in a black pool. So this is already a little bit more ascites, and this is a lot ascites. Let's go to the Budd-Chiari syndrome. That's quite important, especially because these patients will probably present with a severe abdominal pain. What can we see with the ultrasound? We see quite a lot. You have specific signs. Remember the nice hepatic veins that I demonstrated to you in the first patients. They will completely disappear. Patient will develop probably ascites, and the caudate lobe, once again, the caudate lobe that we know from the cirrhosis, will also enlarge. So two cases when we have an enlargement of the caudate lobe, cirrhosis, and Budd-Chiari syndrome. So these were the hepatic veins. So the white lines are remnants of the hepatic vein. This is a typical Budd-Chiari syndrome. And obviously, the liver has to give his blood to the heart, so some collaterals will appear, and the collaterals are visible throughout the whole liver. And here, once again, normally you should appreciate the nice hepatic veins here, and here you have just remnants, fibrotic remnants. This is a Budd-Chiari syndrome, and probably this patient will develop with an acute liver failure or a lot of abdominal pain. What also happens, the caudate lobe, segment 1, which is very small normally, will enlarge, will be very big. And why will it be very big? Because the caudate lobe is the only part of the liver that can drain the blood through to the heart. Because this drains via a vein over here directly in the inferior caval vein. So this is the reason why in a Budd-Chiari syndrome patient we have an enlargement of segment 1. And the drainage will be via here. What can happen as well, we can see with the abdominal ultrasound clearly a thrombus, and this is what we see here. This is a thrombus in the inferior caval vein. So if you have a patient with a vena cava inferior syndrome, we can, with the abdominal ultrasound, sometimes see what the causes of this problem are. Portal vein thrombosis, just the same, patients present with acute abdominal pain, very severe abdominal pain, and we can easily see the diagnosis with the ultrasound. We don't need a CT scan to demonstrate this disorder. You see here, this is the portal vein, this is the liver, and you see clearly in the portal vein a huge thrombus. So this diagnosis can be made on the emergency department. The same here, this is the portal vein, and in the portal vein you see the thrombus. Once again, if you've seen it once, you will see it immediately if you see the patient. Here, this is the portal vein, and here the thrombus is lying into the portal vein. Okay, this for liver disease. Let's go to the gallbladder disorders. Two very important things that you can easily appreciate with your ultrasound: cholecystitis and bile duct dilatation. And I think these are very important for you on the ICU department. Cholecystitis, what will we see? This is the gallbladder. Here we see a stone, and this is the wall of the gallbladder. And normally the wall of the gallbladder you cannot see, you cannot appreciate it, because it's just a wall, it's very thin. And here we see that in between the liver and the gallbladder you see a thickened layer, multiple layered. You see hyperechogenic, hypoechogenic, and hyperechogenic. This is edema in the wall of the gallbladder. This is very diagnostic for cholecystitis. Once again, this is the gallbladder, this is the wall of the gallbladder, multiple layered, and the gallbladder wall is thickened. This is cholecystitis. And this is a complicated cholecystitis, gallbladder perforation and abscess into the liver parenchyma. Diagnosis that you can make with the ultrasound. So you don't have to bring the patient to the CT with everything, you just ask your gastroenterologist to perform the ultrasound. Once again, gallbladder, stones, and here multiple layered gallbladder wall. Once again, gallbladder wall, multiple layered, and sometimes this can become an empyema, and here you see the pus into the gallbladder. Let's go to the common bile duct and bile duct dilatation. You have a patient on the ICU with hyperbilirubinemia. The first thing you want to know are the bile ducts dilated, and you can appreciate it at yourself probably as well. This is the portal vein, and next to the portal vein runs the common bile duct. Normally, if there isn't a problem, you don't see the common bile duct, because the common bile duct normally is less than 5 millimeters. So if you don't see it, don't be afraid, it probably is not dilated. When do you see this that it's dilated? This is the portal vein. This is a dilated bile duct. So if it's dilated, you will see it. If you don't see it, it's probably not dilated. And it's very clear. This is a dilation. Here, once again, this is the portal vein, and this is a dilated common bile duct. Here, once again, portal vein, common bile duct with a stone in the common bile duct. This is inside the liver, so you can appreciate it outside, but you also can look inside the liver. This is the liver, and you see many ducts. If you're a little bit familiar with looking at the liver, sometimes you see one or two, you see the vessels, you see the portal vein tracts, you see the hepatic vein tracts, but this is too much, too many ducts, it's said in English. And very important, they run parallel. In Dutch they say tramlijnbeelden. So they run parallel, and this is because the bile ducts always run parallel with the portal vein tracts. So if you see this and you see them running parallel, then you know it's bile duct dilatation. Here, once again, this is the portal vein and this is the dilated bile duct. What you also can do is put your color Doppler on it. If you're not sure whether or not if this is of this is the portal, just put your color Doppler on it. And if you see structures that don't have flow, then you know that these are the bile ducts. Here, this is what I've done here. So you put your color Doppler on it. If there is flow, you see this is the portal vein tract. And next to the portal vein tract, you see the bile ducts. Okay, let's go to the renal disorders. First, renal stones. This is the kidney. And here you see a hyperechogenic region with a shadow. If you see this, then it's a stone. Also for the bile duct, it's very important. If you see a hyperechogenic lesion with a clear shadow, that's a stone. Here, once again, this is the kidney. This is a kidney stone. And once again, kidney with less clear shadow, but still kidney stone. Looking at dilatation, very easy. You just look the kidney. Remember, here you see this is the parenchyma, this is the sinus renalis. And if you then look at the sinus renalis, if there is a dilatation, you will see it in the sinus renalis. And this is a grade 1, grade 2, and this is a grade 4 dilatation. In this patient, you can appreciate whether sometimes these can be the veins or the arteries. Once again, put your color Doppler on it and you will see whether or not it's veins or arteries or the pillow system that's dilated. Abdominal aneurysm. This is the normal aorta. This is the liver. And you can look at it. It's very superficial, so you can appreciate the whole aorta. And if it's dilated, it's very easy, then it's an aneurysm. And you can measure it. And sometimes you have a true lumen and you have a false lumen. This is very easy. Abdominal trauma is much more difficult. People of you that work on the emergency department, this, for example, is a splenic trauma. And the only thing that you appreciate here is a hyperechogenic region. So I must confess, in patients with an abdominal trauma, it's very difficult to see splenic lesions or liver lesions, and especially the first hours, because in the first hours, the only thing you can appreciate is a hyperechogenic region. Afterwards, it's obviously easy. This is day 4. Then you see the hematoma. Then it's easy. But the first hours after the accident, I think the ultrasound isn't that good. Here, splenic rupture. This is very easy, but this is not what you will see 1 hour after the trauma. Kidney, just the same. Immediately after the trauma, very difficult, and you will see a hyperechogenic region, very difficult. And the days after, of course, it becomes more easy to appreciate, but the first hours, I think CT scan is the best. So you can do it to look at free fluid and things like that, but know that it's not very good, and that CT, in these cases, is much better. Liver trauma, just the same, first hours, very subtle changes, hyperechogenic region sometimes. If you are lucky, here once again, and with CT, we see it much better. Subcapsular hematomas are easier to appreciate. Why? Because they have the typical morphology, so that's more easy to appreciate. This is very important. With the ultrasound, and I think we're not aware of that and we don't use it often, but with the ultrasound we can perfectly diagnose free air. This is the liver, and if you see this, the hyperechogenic lesions on top of the liver, we know it's free air. And very important, this is hyperechogenic, and if we look at the shadow, it's a dirty shadow. Stone is a very clear shadow, but air is a very dirty shadow. It shatters and it moves all the time up and down. Here, once again, this is the liver, and on top of the liver, we see the air. So with the ultrasound, we can make the diagnosis of free air. Here, this was a patient with perforation of a gastric ulcer, and here we have the free air between the liver and the stomach. Few words about bowel pathology. More and more, this is very important, especially for the gastroenterologist, but also on the ICU, I think you will, you have indications. Here we see a patient with a clear colitis. Why? Because we have this is the bowel wall, which is clearly enlarged. This is what we should see normally. Here we see how it should be normally. This is an intussusception, what you also sometimes see, and then you see the bowel goes into the bowel, and we have this cocarde build. Here as well, we have the Cocarde belt. This is also something that we can see with the abdominal ultrasound. Appendicitis, very important. This is the appendix, which has an enlarged bowel wall. And if we put the color Doppler on it, we see a high flow into the bowel wall, the appendix wall. And here, once again, it's a very thick, inflamed bowel wall with the peritoneum around it, which is clearly hyperechogenic, an inflamed peritoneum. So this is what we can see with appendicitis. Colitis, this was a patient with a Clostridium difficile colitis, and once again we see a very thick bowel wall here also with inflammation of the peritoneum around it. So these are things that with a good abdominal ultrasound you can see. Small bowel obstruction. Sometimes we see that. And very nice about this is you can make the differentiation with the ultrasound in between a paralytic ileus and a mechanic ileus. Because with the mechanic ileus, you clearly see the bowels moving, and paralytic, everything is silent. Voila. I think this was a very fast overview in the abdominal ultrasound. But my tips and tricks are, if you do the ultrasound, do it properly and do the whole abdomen. If the patient is alert and you can ask questions, it's very nice because you can ask the patient, demonstrate me where it hurts. For an appendicitis, for example, I always ask the patient, demonstrate me with your finger where you have pain. And you can go with your probe to the place where the patient points at that he's painless. And very important, I think, for you guys, in trauma patients, be aware that it's not the best examination. For all the other things, you can always ask the gastroenterologist, but I think for trauma patients, ultrasound is clearly inferior. Are there any questions?